Welcome to the DevOps on Azure webinar series. You are watching the fourth part. In this topic, we will talk about the Docker orchestration systems. My name is Agnes Kovács. I'm a cloud solution architect, and I will be the host of the English version of the webinar, what was created by our open source partner, Nextent. The webinar is also available in Hungarian language. Let us see the agenda first. So we will talk about the various orchestration systems like Docker, Swarm, DCOS, and Kubernetes. And at the very end, we will also show you how to build a demo. We will create a Kubernetes cluster, and we will learn how to manage it. First of all, let us have a look at the Docker orchestration systems. In this webinar, we will talk about three of them, so Kubernetes, Apache Mesos, and Docker Swarm. First, I will talk about Docker Swarm. Docker Swarm is the native orchestration systems, what comes with Docker itself, and that's it. The second is DCOS or Mesos. So DCOS, what you need to know about is it has been created based on Apache Mesos and Marathon. And what is the main characteristic of this orchestration system? That if you connect multiple cluster nodes into cluster, then this orchestration system let you see these servers as one big computer. So for example, if you have like four servers with 4 gigabyte RAM and 4 CPUs, you will see 16 gigabyte RAM and 16 CPUs at the very end. Why is DCOS good? First of all, if you would like to scale up to 10,000 nodes, then this is the orchestration system for you. It is high available, it is fault tolerant, it uses Zookeeper, and it is natively supporting Docker containers, and it provides also isolation between the Linux containers. Let's have a look at its architecture. As you can see, it is high available and fault tolerant. It uses three masters. And there is also a quorum from the three masters. One is the master and the other ones are standby, and they are using the quorum to vote which is the master. And then we also have our nodes where a lot of processes can run, also Docker, but Mesos can handle. And the masters are, as mentioned before, the masters are connected via Zookeeper. Okay. Let us move to Kubernetes. What you need to know about Kubernetes that it's Google's open source container orchestration solution. It has been started by Google, but from Google, the Cloud Native Computing Foundation has taken over its development, and since then this organization is taking care of its development and watching over it. Let's have a look at its architecture. As you can see, also in this architecture we have a master. Of course, you can have multiple masters. Here in this figure you can see only one. We have also nodes, these are called minions, and here on these minions the Docker is running, and we have additional layer, it is called pods. Pod is a logical layer where you can group, you can have multiple containers, you can build mini architectures there. Okay. How Kubernetes is running in Azure. If we would like to use Kubernetes with any cloud provider, and in this case we will use it within Azure, the most important thing what we have to be able to achieve is that if we create a service, and Docker container, and we create a port and we would like to make this service available, we have to take care of the load balancing. And fortunately, Azure and Kubernetes are working well together, so Azure Load Balancer will take care of it. During the demo, we will also use this and we will show you how to create such a setup. So, and let's have a look at the demo. So, let us look at the demo. First, we will install a Kubernetes cluster into Azure. And we will do it do this into the Azure Container Services with the Azure CLI. Let us create a resource group. And the resource group has been created successfully. This is where we will run our cluster. And then we will create our cluster. Of course, we can control via the parameters how many masters and nodes we would like to have. But in this demo, we are using the default settings, what is one master and three nodes. So as you can see, that's the command. And the cluster has been created. Of course, it needs to take more time. After a cluster has been created, we will create a container registry where we will store our images. If you are interested about it more, please look at the previous webinar. After our registry has been created, as you can see here, we will need to create a user. This user will be used to connect with Docker login, and we will do our images within this Docker registry. Of course, you may want to change the ID and the password. And if we have done everything right, we will be able to do a Docker login to this registry. As you can see, the login succeeded. Okay, now we have a Kubernetes cluster, and on the portal, we can see that the Azure CLI has created for us a lot of services. So not just the cluster is containing of multiple Azure resources. Once we have finished checking the portal, we need to install on our machine the Kubernetes CLI, aka kubectl. We can achieve this also with the Azure CLI as well. We only need to run an Azure CLI command, what will install for us the kubectl as shown here. After we have successfully installed this, we need to run a command that will enable us to manage our Kubernetes cluster from our local machine. This command will login us with the credentials of our Azure CLI to be able to connect to our Kubernetes cluster. Here we need to wait a little. We got back the prompt. As you can see, we were able to login successfully. After the kubectl is installed, we can check the status of our cluster with the kubectl get nodes command, as shown here. As you can see, we have one master and we have three agent nodes where we can run our containers and pods. Let us run an image on this cluster, and we will use an Nginx image for this. With the following kubectl command, we can achieve this. So kubectl run nginx -- image nginx. Once you issue the command, it gets back the prompt. As we can see, the command gets as a result an nginx has been created and deployed. Nginx is running with the one replica set, if we check it with the kubectl get deployments. So it is running with one replica set, one desired, one current, and one up to date and one available. Now we would like to expose this Nginx and make it available to the internet. And as you can remember, in our previous webinars, we have sold it with network security groups. And since Kubernetes and Azure are integrated very well together, we can use another command, this kubectl expose deployments command, to expose our Nginx 80 port. And this command will also expose it, and it will be done through an Azure load balancer. We can check this service as well. As you can see here, the Nginx service has an internal IP address. We can check the service as well. So it has an internal IP address, and its external IP address is, has not been created yet, but it is creating. The pending status means that our Azure Load Balancer is working on it. We need to wait a little. If you want to monitor it, you can query it with kubectl get-svc, or you can make it wrap it in a wedge command. And as you can see, the external IP address has arrived, and now we have done everything. If we have done everything right, we will be able to reach our Nginx. And here is it. With this example, you could see how Kubernetes works. Additionally, we would like to show you how you can implement such a deployment with your own image. And we would like also to demonstrate you a rolling upgrade. So during our previous Docker webinar, we have created a Docker file. And we will edit this file again. So here is that Docker file. If we edit that Docker file, as you can see, we have derived it from the Apache PHP image. And we have copied the content of the SRC, and we have exposed the 80 command. Now we will create an index.html. So not a PHP, but an HTML. And within this, we will just simply write DevOps webinar 2017 version 1 v1. As a second step, we will build this image, and we will need to run this command where our Docker file is. So once we hit this, the build will start. And once this step has finished, as you can remember from previous webinar, we will need to tag this image. Once we have tagged this image, we can check that it has been done. And there is the V1 image. We have to push this image to our registry. So first of all, after the tagging, we push it. The push command will copy the image from our local machine to the container registry within Azure. As you can see, the push has been started. Once this is done, we can check with Azure CLI if the image has been successfully uploaded to the registry. As you can see, the image is there. You cannot see the tag with this command, but it is really there. If we would like to reach this registry from our Kubernetes cluster, we will need to tell our cluster the credentials with kubectl create a secret command. So we will have to make sure that our Kubernetes cluster is able to reach with the right credentials or registry within Azure. So here you can see the command. We will need some values from our own container registry, what we have created previously. Here is the command. And as you can see, this my registry key has been created successfully. We can also check this with kubectl get secrets, and there is our registry key. To be able to deploy an application into a Kubernetes cluster, we will need to create a YAML file where we will define what we would like to do during the deployment. So first, let us create this file. And we will use this file later on to start the deployment within Kubernetes. Let us name the file azure-deployment.yaml. I have copied the description into the file, and now let us go through the pieces. So first, there is a service called MyAppSVC, and then there is the port, the 80 port that needs to be exposed, and there will be a deployment where I can set the application, how many replica sets should be created. As you can see there, there is the replica set. And at the spec, we will also tell the name of our app and also which image needs to be used, which image needs to be deployed. And in the image pool secrets, we also have to name the My Registry key what we have created before, so that's secret. If we have edited this file, as you can see, we saved the file. Now we can run the kubectl create command on this file. And as you can see, the deployment has been created. With the kubectl get deployment command, you can check the status of this deployment. As you can see, there is our app. Additionally, you can also run kubectl get svc. And we can see our application there. And as you can see, the external IP address is pending. Previously, I have mentioned that this deployment will have three replica sets. You can check this by running the kubectl get pods command. As shown here, there are our three replicas. You can imagine this as having three containers. And I am load balancing the traffic between them. So we have a load balancer in front of them. And if we check now the service, you can see the IP address there. And if we go to this IP address, we will see the PHP info. And if we check the index.html, we will see the version 1. So now, how can we modify these images and how modification looks like? So first of all, we will go back to the machine where we have done the build of the images, and I will delete the index.php file. And then we will edit the index.html to v2. And once this is done, we will have in the index.html the v2, so this is our new version. We will go through the other steps we have already done, like tagging the image. And we will again push it to the registry. Now we will tag this image to V2. And then we build this image. It has been successfully built. And now we will check this image. The V2 image is there, as you can see, it has been built. What we have done so far, we have a Kubernetes cluster, we have a container registry, we have our own image V1, and we changed it to V2. And how we can deploy this? So first of all, we check the deployment. And one way to do is to set the image with the kubectl set image deployment command. And if we set this image, this V2 image, then this is one way to do it. The other way is to use kubectl edit deployment. This will enable us to edit the YAML file we have created before. As you can see, here you can also change the image to the V2. Now we have V1 and we can change it to V2. And if you save it, then you can see that it has been edited. If we look at the kubectl get pods, now you see that there is a error, this error image pool. It means that if you see this error message, then there is a mistake here. And what we have omitted is that I haven't pushed this image to the registry. But I will do it right now. So there is the docker push command. And as you can see, a lot of layers already existing. So it will finish very quickly. So once this docker push has finished, we can go back to our Kubernetes cluster and we can check our pods. And as you can see, there is this image pool back off state, but means that once the image has been pushed and it was able to reach it, it has found it, and now all the pods are running again. So we can check, and all the pods are running, as shown here with the kubectl get pods. With the kubectl get pods, you can get the name of the pods, and with the kubectl describe pods, you can see additional information about the pod itself. As you can see, there is the error message. And once I have uploaded the right image, it has changed the status to backoff, and it has started to pull the image and started the pods. So this is also one way how to do. If we have done everything right, then our index.html will show V2. As you can see, we could do it in a very simple way. At the very end, I would like to show you a comment which you can use to check the rolling upgrade. This comes handy if you have a large deployment. The kubectl rollout status command. But first we need to check the deployment, and we have to have the name of the deployment. So that's the name of the deployment, and now we will run the kubectl roller status into this deployment name. And as you can see, it says that it has rolled out. There is also a possibility to look at the history, and you can see there is also a change cause here, but I haven't filled out, but you can do it. And you can track which changes have been done to your pods. And there is also a possibility to undo your changes with the kubectl rollout undo. Of course, you have to provide the name of the deployment. And once you have done that, we can check the index.html, and now it is v1. In the next episode, you can learn more about version control systems and how to use Git.